I shall not be.
For us, who can be against us? Praise God. We've got his backing, if you will. Praise the Lord. I forgot to welcome those of you who are on the live stream. Forgive me. Praise God. Blame it on Will. No, but it's a joy to have you with us. It is prayer time, praise God. And I'm sure some of us here, and even those of you who are on live stream, may have some concerns that you need to express, that you want the saints to know about. This is the opportunity to go ahead and send in your prayer requests. that we might lift it up before our God. And for those of us here who may have a spoken request, this is time that we would be doing it. I just want to say before you make your request, there are some brothers that I am in ministry with. One of them's wife has the COVID. One of them's daughter has the COVID virus. And so let's remember them in a very special way. I even shared with you about a little boy, DJ, who has a brain disease that is incurable. And so we're gonna keep him lifted up. His mother just died a few weeks ago, and now he's found out that he has this issue, praise God. And I can only imagine a 10-year-old having to deal with all of that, praise God. So let's keep little DJ lifted up. God is a healer, amen. God is able to touch DJ and to take care of his whole situation. And so, as always, our sick and shut in, we lift up our lost family members, we lift up. And if you have any other prayer requests that you would like to voice, now would be the time. Going once, going twice, sold, it's over. Praise God. Well, I'm sure there's some unspoken requests that you would like to lift up before the Lord. Amen. And not to see every hand would cause me to worry just a little bit, praise God, because I know all of us have issues that we need God to deal with, we need help with. And so at this time, I'm going to ask my dear sister Alice if she would voice this prayer for us.
Our holy and heavenly Father, we're coming to you as humble as we know how. We first want to thank you, Heavenly Father. You touched us early this morning. You woke us up. You didn't let us slumber too long. You allowed us to have a little bit of our thinking, and our limbs are working fine. We want to thank you for that. You brought us out to the house of worship, Heavenly Father. We want to thank you for your love. We want to thank you for everything that you look out for us in our behalf. We want to bring our prayer request to you, Heavenly Father. We want to hold up DJ, Heavenly Father. He's a little somebody, Heavenly Father, and he's probably wondering what is going on. We just ask you to stop by, Heavenly Father. Let him know that he is not alone, Heavenly Father. If he doesn't know you for himself, Heavenly Father, just tap him on the shoulder and let him know he is loved. We want to lift him up to you in a mighty way, and the family, Heavenly Father, who's ever caring for him, if it's a dad or an aunt or a grandparent, we want to lift up them in their household, Heavenly Father. Give them strength. I understand his mom just have transitioned over. Strengthen that family for the bereavement and for this disease that he's going through, this illness he's going through. We hold up our loved ones, Heavenly Father, the ones who don't know in the pardons of their sins. We ask you to stop by and just touch them, Heavenly Father, so they know. They know it's not them making decisions, but you are sitting high and looking low. You are doing things in their behalf. You're opening up those unseen doors of employment. You're opening up those financial doors in their behalf. You're going to the hospital with them and being in the surgery room with them. And we also want to hold up our pastor, Heavenly Father. Touch him in a mighty way, Heavenly Father. Heal him in a mighty way, Heavenly Father, and his family, Heavenly Father. We want to just hold them up. Keep them comfort, Heavenly Father, and the Walker family that have lost the daughter, Heavenly Father. This is a very sensitive area, Heavenly Father. When you call a child home, we know she's in a good place, but just comfort the family, Heavenly Father. Mend them closer together, Heavenly Father. We just ask for a super prayer for them. And anyone else is going through something, you know all about them and are sick and shut in. We ask you to stop by and see them, Heavenly Father. Some of our older saints, we want to also hold up Ivan and Edna. We want to hold up Sister Connie, Heavenly Father, Sister Tab and Sister Lassiter, and anyone else that needs a touch from you, we ask you to stop by, Heavenly Father. Let them know this is a very sensitive season, Heavenly Father, for some that have lost their loved ones. This might be their first time going through this holiday season and their loved ones not here. We just ask you to stop by and keep them strong, Heavenly Father. Keep their minds stayed on you, Heavenly Father, because a lot of times people just don't know what to do. We just ask you to stop by and give them a touch and give them some love. We lay everything at your feet, Heavenly Father, and we say thank you for all the things that you're doing in our behalf, the things that you're working on, and the things that's going to be coming our way. In your precious name, amen.
Amen. Just to give you an update on Pastor Robinson, he's doing fine, praise God. I'm sure he's probably tuned in right now as we speak. But I talked to him, and he's doing fine. The surgery went well. He is having some pain naturally, but he is able to move around. He told the doctors, told him to walk around and, move just a little bit. But praise God. And so we just pray for healing that is swift and hold. Amen. Amen. Praise God. At this time, we're going to have our offering. Praise the Lord. Did everybody go to sleep? Yeah. Praise the Lord. Thank you. And like all of a sudden, everybody just went. We thank God that we have to give, don't we? Praise God. I thank God that I have to give, that he is providing for me. I got a roof over my head, and I got two pair of shoes and a shirt. Praise God. It's all because of him. Hallelujah. And so we just thank God that he has blessed us. And if we obey God, as he has said, that we're to bring our tithe, the whole tithe, praise God, that he would open up the windows of heaven and just continue to pour out blessings. Amen. So come in no certain order. Praise the Lord. We also want to thank you who are live streaming with us. Some of you are members. Some of you, maybe not, but those of you who support the ministry, we appreciate every gift, and we pray God bless you for being a supporter of this ministry. Father, we thank you for this offering. We thank you, Lord God, that we have to give. You have been faithful to give to us. And you've blessed us in ways that money just couldn't. And so, Father, bless this offering in a very special way. But you know what it's going to be used for, and we pray that you would breathe on it, and I'm sure you'll make it what it needs to be as we seek to help those who are in need. And so thank you, Lord God. Bless everyone whose hand was free today. We just give it all to you in Jesus' name. Amen. We'll try to take your... Well, Clarence says you have enough jobs. Quit trying to take it. Amen. Amen. Well, I just want to share a little of what the Lord has put in my spirit today. I pray that you would be attentive, open-minded, and open heart to hear what God has to say. Father, I thank you for this opportunity. It's a privilege. It's also a task, Lord God, that couldn't be done without your help. Simply, Lord God, bless this vessel of clay, this ignorant, unlearned person who have spent time with you. And I pray, Father, in the name of Jesus, that you would move in a very special way to help me clearly share what you have put in my heart and spirit for us today. And so, Lord God, I give myself over to you, submit and surrender to you, and simply ask you to have your way. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise the Lord. Turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 4. I think my glasses are getting in the way now. I want to share something that the Lord put in my spirit. The title, if you will, is Christ Suffered in the Flesh. And I want to share from 1 Peter 4, 1 through 8, and I'm going to read it and then come back and share some thoughts that I believe God put in my spirit, all right? It says, therefore, since Christ suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves also with the same mind, for he who has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, that he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh or in the lust of men, but for the will of God. For we have spent enough of our past lifetime in doing the will of the Gentiles, when we walked in lewdness, lust, drunkenness, revelries, drinking parties, and abominable idolatries. In regard to these, they think it strange that you do not run with them in the same flood of dispensation, speaking evil of you. They will give an account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. For this reason, the gospel was preached also to those who are dead, that they might be judged according to men in the flesh, but live according to God in the spirit. But the end of all things is at hand. Therefore, be serious and watchful in your prayers. And above all things have fervent love one for another. Love will cover a multitude of sin. Praise the Lord. May he add a blessing to this word. Verse 1, it says, therefore, since Christ suffered for us in the flesh. I want to stop right there just to say we have to always consider the price that God paid for our salvation. For Christ to suffer in the flesh, meaning that he took upon the sins of the world, hallelujah, on that cross on our behalf in exchange for his righteousness, is something that we just can't fathom. When we think about the pain, listen, think about the pain that he suffered for the world's sin. In time past, in time present, God suffered in his flesh, in his, we can't comprehend that kind of pain. Amen. But he did it for us. Hallelujah. And so he goes on to say, arm yourselves also with the same mind. For he who has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin. To arm yourself, he is saying, to equip yourself, to get ready. Hallelujah. Because we need to make up our mind that as he suffered for us in the flesh, we need to be ready to suffer for him. So Philippians says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made of himself no reputation, taking on the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men. Being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and came obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. Hallelujah. And so Jesus, who is equal with God, the Son of God, humbled himself, came down to earth, put on this nasty flesh. Hallelujah. Didn't worry about his reputation, what people would think about him. Praise God, that's a good one. That's one we need to always look at. And found himself as appearance of man, he humbled himself to the point of obedience of death, even death on the cross. 1 Peter 2:21 says, for to this you were called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that we should follow in his footsteps. You hear that? Or that we should always be ready to suffer for him. Let me say this. All suffering is not for Christ, because we're Christians. That doesn't mean everything we suffer is for Christ. Amen. I think I need to make that clear. We can't associate all our suffering as because we are saints of God. There is a suffering that we should be ready to suffer. There is a suffering that we will suffer, praise God, for Christ. But I need to make it clear, just because we are Christians, that doesn't mean everything we go through, the suffering we go through, is for Christ. Amen. For he who has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin. This passage, if not understood in the right way, sounds like it's saying you can stop sinning altogether. Look at it. He who has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin. Are you with me? That's not true anywhere in Scripture. Amen. That's not true anywhere. Commentators have several views on what this passage means. I'll attempt to share of them what I believe the Spirit shared with me. First of all, I believe first it could be saying that when we are born again, we are baptized in Christ and baptized publicly before friends and family, we are saying that we have ceased from sin and our old way of life. You follow what I'm saying? Am I making sense right now? When we gave our life to Christ and we got baptized, we were baptized into Christ Jesus, we invited our friends and family, I know I did, to my baptism. I was saying to the world, my old life I am doing away with. That old sinful way that I was living, it stops here, praise God. And now I'm going to go in a new direction, in a new way of life. All right? We have made a decision. Listen, when that happened, we made a decision in our new way of life, we are not going to live in sin anymore. How many of you know that even though we meant that decision not to sin, we find that what we said and meant to do in not sinning was not completely true? Let's be real here. It was not completely true. I should be getting, praise God, everybody's attention by now. We couldn't completely carry it out. And we can, you know what I found out, as I look back, God did some things in me, you've heard the story, took some things out of me, cussing, smoking, drinking, drugs, all, just took it out, praise God. And time was good for a while. I was happy, I'm telling everybody about Jesus, and, but then there came a time where God says, okay, it's time to grow up, son. Are you listening? It's time to grow up. And so it's time to grow up, and he starts dealing with us on some of the, with some of the sin we haven't let go yet. Right? Yeah, because even though God did something in our experience to let people know something has happened in us, there's a change in us. Yeah, there's still some sin, praise God, that we haven't let go yet. We start to experience that the child of God, the child God loves, he also punishes. And it hurts. He begins a purification process, and the more it hurts, the more we're purified, until our decision not to sin becomes stronger and stronger. Amen. If we look at Hebrews chapter 12, 5 through, chapter 12, 5 through 12 or 11, he talks about this whole idea of us being sons and daughters of God. And that because he loves us, he'll chastise us, he'll punish us for sin. For he has suffered in the flesh, has ceased from sin. In maturity, we have made up our mind not to sin because sin hurts. Does sin hurt? Amen. There's a consequence to sin. Amen. There's a built-in consequence. God is not sitting up in heaven and when you sin, send something to zap you. The consequence is already built in the sin. Amen. And God is trying to help us more and more and more through the pain of us doing what we want to do, going against what God has commanded, and helping us to understand we need to really make up in our mind a stronger decision not to sin. Amen. We can't take the little sins lightly. Amen. Yeah, so we consider little sins. We consider, or we sometimes think we can deal with the consequence according to this. Amen. Hey, I know it's true because I've thought it. Hey, let's be real here. I know it's true because I've thought it. I've done it. Hallelujah. But God began to show me, praise God, that there are some things you need to quit doing if you want to stop some of the pain. Oh, man. Amen. I'm going somewhere. In maturity, we have made up our mind not to sin because sin hurts. But also, we learned Jesus paid a great price to free us from sin. That ought to do something in our hearts to help us Jesus paid a great price, as I shared how he suffered in the flesh for us, praise God, that we would not sin. Sending back the power of the Holy Spirit to live in us, to help us conquer sin. But I want to come back and let us say, the Bible never says we will not sin. Amen. Because we are in this flesh, we come up short. We come up short in our thinking. We come up short in our response to people sometimes. We come up short on some of the commandments of God. Hey, it's not deliberate and rebellion. It's just that in this flesh, you can't hit the mark 100% all the time. But we can live in a way that as we're out among people, dealing with people, they see in us a righteousness, hallelujah, or a difference from the way we used to live, a difference from the way people around us live, praise God, that is not sinful according to the commandments of God. Amen. That's what we should be striving for. To do that, we're going to have to humble ourselves. To do that, we're going to have to take some things we wouldn't take before. I learned early on that there were some things I would have to take, I would not take from any person before. Amen. But God said I had to. If I was going to fulfill the call on my life and live out this life in the way as obedient to him, I got to take, like Christ took some things, I'm going to have to take some things. And so one of the things that I'm going to have to take, some people just going to talk crazy to you. And you got to take it. And I had somebody to do that to, and it hurt me so bad. You heard the story. It hurt me so, I wasn't used to that. I went home and I cried like a baby. I was not used to people just talking to me the way they wanted to talk to me. Don't care who you are, who you know. That just wasn't me. But now, oh God, now I have to. Hallelujah. That's suffering for Christ. Amen. That right there is suffering for Christ. 1 Peter 4:2-3 says that he no longer shall live the rest of his time in the flesh for the lust of men, but for the will of God. When we say for the lust of men, I believe that he is saying that we should not stop trying to live our life trying to fit in with the world. Trying to fit in with folk. There are some believers that seem like they just want to fit in. Amen. Well, if we are different, how can we fit in? If we're a light that stands up, that is set up on a hill for all to see, how can we fit in this way and with the ways of the world? Amen. We're not called to fit in with the ways of the world. We can influence the world by living in the same ways of the world, praise God. We've got to be different. But find out what the will of God is for your life and live that out. Amen. We need to find out. We need to find out what the will of God is for our life and live that out. Listen to this. 1 Peter 4:3. For we have spent enough past lifetime in doing the will of the Gentiles, when we walked in lewdness, lust, drunkenness, revelries, drinking parties, abominable idolatries, lewdness, lust, drunkenness. Oh, I wrote it, I taped it twice. recorded it twice. Amen. I did. And abominable. It must need it to be said twice, huh? I believe this for the new believer as well as the old. Because these people are coming out of all kinds of pagan lifestyles. Amen. Living all kinds of, I've lived a lot of this myself, if not all of it. Amen. I lived out of this. And so it says we spend enough time in that kind of life. Praise God. Romans 6:21 says, what fruit did you have in them things of which you are now ashamed? For the end of those things is death. There are some things that I've done that I'm ashamed of. Amen. There's some things that I've done that I've been a part of that really I am ashamed of today. Praise God, but I've been forgiven. It's in the past. Praise God, God has cleansed me from all that. But he is helping those new believers to understand that they need to come out of that way of life. And he is helping us to understand, be careful we don't slip back into that way of life. Amen. Because the end of those things is death or destruction or ruin, praise God. Sin ruined us. Amen. Sin ruined me. Living like I wanted to live, drinking and partying and doing drugs. I messed up relationships. I lost good jobs. All kinds of things happened. That stuff hurts. And he's trying to help us to stay up out of that kind of lifestyle because that lifestyle hurts. Amen. And you're just going to end up ashamed of all the things. When you listen, can I be real? Whenever or if ever we sin and we're convicted, that shame comes on us. Amen. Amen. That guilt comes on us. Yeah. Amen. Because we know we were wrong. And God lets us know immediately that we were wrong. And you've got to deal with that guilt and you've got to deal with that. And there's a process of coming out of that. And so God is trying to help us to understand. Make a decision in your heart and mind not to sin. Amen. So that you won't have to experience this stuff all the time. There was a time when I didn't care what nobody think. I did what I was going to do. Amen. A friend of mine I used to run with, he used to come by and get me. He said, Leon, let's go get welded in tonight. Talking about welded into a cell. Me and Shaky, Ren know what I'm talking about. That means we're going to do whatever we want to do. And if we wound up welded in a cell, so what? Amen. And we went on and did some crazy stuff. It's a wonder that I'm not welded in a cell, praise God. Amen. And it goes on to say, in regard to these things, they think it's strange that you do not run with them in the same flood of dispensation, speaking evil of you. Or when you came out of it, there's a lot of people thought it was strange that you didn't continue to run in the same wildness of life, if you will, as you had always done. And so they spoke evil of you. And I've had a few. Amen. Holier than thou. And they say all kinds of stuff. And praise God. But I thank God I'm just not one of those kind of people who just worried about what other people think. Sometimes where people can't get saved because they're worried about what somebody else thinks. And because my mom always taught me to think for myself, praise God, when I made a decision to do what I did it in regard of what they would think or what they would say. My mother told me when I was very young, she said, don't be a follower. And if you're not part of the group, that's helping to make decisions of the group, start your own group. But don't be listening to other folk telling you. And them telling you what to do. And so I didn't. I never have, praise God. Those that used to run with you might get angry with you. They might speak evil of you. But listen, some should be amazed, curious, glad to see the change because it gives them hope of change of life for themselves. Yeah. That's what happens when we make up in our mind to stop sinning. Amen. And do right by God. It gives people hope that they can change too. Everybody out there is not just people, you know what I'm saying, bent on evil and wicked and don't care. No. There's enough of them out there. But there are plenty of people looking for a way out and don't know how to get out. I was one of them. When I was stuck in my addiction, I looked back on my life and I'm like, I had so much better than this. I had nice apartments, new cars, clothes, even tailor-made clothes. You know what I'm saying? Able to dress and run with the best of them. You follow what I'm saying? But when I failed in my addiction, I was thinking about, look at what I had. How did I get here? You know what I'm saying? And I wanted a way out, and I believe God saw a way out in my heart because he gave me a way out. I tell myself, I'm not going to keep living like this. That somehow, you know what I'm saying? I'm going to get out of this, not knowing how. But I kept telling myself that, and God kept hearing me telling myself that. And God made a way for me to get out. Amen? And I had a person come to me about 3 years into my walk with the Lord. And he told me this. He said, Leon, I've been watching you for about 3 years now. He said, first I thought this was just some kind of fad, but this is what he said. He said, this is serious. You're serious about this. And then he said, would you pray for me? Amen. And he asked me to pray for him. Because people are looking for something different. Some people want to get out, like I said, but they just don't know how to get out. But you can't be, let those who are talking about you and angry that you're coming out bother you. For some people, it causes them to kind of, because they want to fit in, they can slowly work themselves back in. Amen. Y'all don't believe that's true? It's very true, praise God. When I was in my early, in my first year, I think it was my first year, I'm sharing, you know, look at what God done for me, changed me, and I had no friends. I didn't know anybody in the church well enough to hang out with. All I knew was those outside of church, and before I know it, I found myself back in the crack house that God saved me from. And somebody came to me and they said, what are you doing in here? Really, they were shocked because what they had saw, praise God, how I changed for me to be back in that place, it blew their mind. But God lifted me up again, praise God. And I called my mom and I said, I'm coming back to church. That was March of 1995 and I haven't looked back since. I'm going to hang in here till I find some friends. I'm going to hang in here till I make some friends, praise God, because I made up my mind. God has got me out of there again. I'm not going back. I'm not going back for no one, praise God. And the Bible goes on to say in verse 5, they will give an account to him who's ready to judge the living and the dead. Those people who may be talking about you and they're upset because you've come out and you're living a different lifestyle, praise God. They're going to have to give an account for themselves, for their own life. So don't worry about them. Amen. Don't get caught up in what they think about you, how they feel about what you're doing. They are going to have to give an account for their lives. 6 says, for this reason, the gospel was preached also to those that are dead, that they might be judged according to men in the flesh, but alive according to God in the spirit. Now, I want to read these two passages before I comment on that, because I think it will help us to understand. 2 Corinthians 5:8 say, we are confident, yes, well pleased, rather to be absent from the body, to be present with the Lord. Hebrews 9:27 says, it is appointed unto men once to die, but after that, the judgment. So he is not talking about those people who are actually dead, but he is talking about people simply dead in their sin. Amen. Are you listening? He is talking about people who are dead in their sin. But as I studied this, it encompasses so much when you actually get into this and studying this. But here it is in a nutshell. In a nutshell, it is saying those past who have died, praise God, they were given a chance, praise God, to come into a relationship with God. You follow what I'm saying? The Bible says they'll be judged according to the flesh. But then there's those since Jesus Christ has came who have heard the gospel, have been given a chance to hear the gospel and accept Jesus Christ. You follow what I'm saying? And so God's going to judge the living and the dead, but he's helping us to understand that God has and we'll share the word of God with every creature. Everybody's going to get a chance at this salvation. Amen. Because if God does not give them a chance, hallelujah, you have to think, why would he judge them? And they never had a chance. They never heard the gospel. They never knew who Jesus Christ was. So how could he judge them for something that they never knew? Everybody will get a chance. Everybody would is going to be judged, praise God, both past, present, and future. First Peter 4:7-8 says, but the end of all things is at hand, therefore be serious and watchful in your prayers. There's two meanings to this. The end is at hand could mean that those of us here physically, our end could be closed. Amen. It's been appointed unto man once to die, did the judgment. Praise God. And the Bible says God is going to come back, not to deal with sin, but for those who eagerly await him. Amen. And so, where am I? Okay. So the end of all things is near could be us checking out, or the end of all things could be near me. Christ could come at any time. And that's what the first century church believed. The first century church lived like they did and did what they did because they believe that Christ could come at any time. And they wanted to be ready when he came. That's why possessions didn't mean anything to them. They freely in Acts chapter 2 and 4 gave of their possession, selling property, because they understand this is not going to do me any good if Christ comes. Amen. So they lived a different life with a different way of thinking because they believed that Christ could come anytime. Today, the church really doesn't take that to heart. Today, the church, I believe we really think, some of us, that we've got time to do all that we want to do. Amen. And that's not true. So we dabble in certain stuff because we've got time to clean it up. Come on now. We can play with a few things God has said not to because of the pleasure of it. We'll do it for a while continually because we've got time to clean it up. Well, he is saying here, hey, the end of all things is at hand. Therefore, be serious. Serious about your lifestyle. Amen. Serious about your obedience to Christ. Serious about what God has called you to and called you to be. Serious about it. And watchful in your prayers, or when you pray, praise God. Don't just throw up a few words to God and say in Jesus' name. No, be sober-minded, be intentional about your prayer, asking God to help you where you struggle. Amen. Asking God to deal with you concerning situations you might have even with other people. Asking God to show you his will for your life so you might fulfill it. It's being serious and intentional in our prayers. Hallelujah. Because we want to be found doing well when Jesus comes. Romans 13:11 says, and do this knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep, for now our salvation is nearer than we first believed. That is saying the same thing. Partially, that is saying the same thing. The time for us leaving here is getting closer and closer. The time for Christ coming back is getting closer and closer. Amen. For some, it could possibly be sharing about those of us who are getting up in age, praise God. Time to go home is getting closer. Amen. Because of time spent and what the word of God has declared, we can see that we are actually come into the last days and time could end at any time. Amen. And so it says we're to be watchful, we're to be serious. And above all things, have fervent love for one another, for love will cover a multitude of sins. Fervent love, a burning love, a real love. Listen, love does not agree with sin, but love forgives sin. Love is patient with sinners. Love shows compassion and is always ready to help. God's love is unconditional. The Bible says, let love be without hypocrisy. Don't be pretending we love people. Our love should be real. Amen. It should be sincere from the heart. Amen. Not trying to make somebody think something that's really not in our heart. Amen. Love, God's love, let me help us here, loves everybody. Amen. When we were born again and the Spirit of God came within us, that Spirit of God, which is Christ Jesus, loves everybody. And that kind of love God wants to express through us. And it's something we can't pretend to do because people can see right through it when you're just being a hypocrite and a phony. Amen. You've heard me say this before in my little group we hung out with. We used to say phony's not allowed because a phony will get you killed. Yeah, you got to know who you're running with when you're out there in those streets. Because somebody pretending will get you killed. Amen. And so God is saying, don't be pretending. Amen. Listen, if you got a problem with somebody, pray about it. Ask God to take that thing out of you. Amen. Don't sit and hold on to it because your flesh loves to feel angry at them. Ask God to remove that. I've had to do it. It took a while, but God brought it out. And the same person I would see and I just wanted to hurt. One day I saw him and I had a whole different understanding, a whole different perspective, a whole different feeling. I actually began to pity that person. And then try to share with that person. And with, you know what? God fixed it. God fixed him and God fixed me, praise God. And come to really respect that brother and love that brother and him me. Amen. But I told the Lord in prayer, I said, if you don't do anything with him, take it out of me. Amen. Because I don't want to feel like this about of this man. I don't want to, every time I see this man, I just get this uneasiness and this anger dwells up because that's real. It can happen with us. It can happen with us and we can actually feel like that. And so he says, let love be without hypocrisy. Abhor what is evil, cling to what is good. You know, this is the Christmas season. Amen. And like I said earlier, I'm really starting to feel the Christmas season. But in the Christmas season, every Christmas, and you're going to hear this a lot throughout this month, all the way up to Christmas, and that's Matthew 1:21. God came to save, Jesus came to save his people from their sin. That is something God is always trying to do. Save us from our sin. Because there is sin in us, or there is something in us that God is always trying to, it's part of the sanctification process, cleanse us from. He's never trying to cleanse us from doing what is right. So there has to be some sort of falling short. I really sometimes hate that because it doesn't sound, it's sin. To fall short is to miss the mark. To miss the mark is sin. Amen. Some people may feel, you know, like falling short. Falling short might make you feel good about yourself. The bottom line is sin. What God is trying to purify and cleanse all of us from. And so the more we understand how God suffered for us in the flesh, the more we understand about how much God really loves us, hallelujah, the more we understand that sin hurts, is the more we will make a decision in our lives, praise God, concerning whatever God puts his finger on to deal with it. Yeah. Amen. Simple as that. Yeah. Whatever God puts his finger on to deal with, if it's pride and God puts his finger, deal with the pride. Amen. Because pride is a biggie. What I found out about pride, you can tell a prideful person something about themselves. The prideful person can see that you are right about what you've said, praise God, and still believe they're right in what they are doing. If that boy, if you can comprehend that, it'll go a long way. Amen. And so let us be watchful. Amen. The time is at hand. Let us be serious when we we get in the presence of God concerning prayer to help us in every way we need help, praise God, and to deal with whatever in us, praise God, that might be hindering us from actually fulfilling the purpose and the call that is on our lives. And we've got to learn to ask God to help us to love unconditionally so that that love will cover a multitude of sin. And we would have a compassionate heart towards sinners, a patient heart towards sinners. And we don't have to agree, and we should not agree with the sin, but we should love the person and do our best to help the person know that God loves them right where they are. Praise God. Hallelujah. Those of you out there who are streaming with us, I just want to make this invitation. If you feel a tug on your heart, if you feel a conviction in your spirit, if you feel emptiness in your soul, I want you to know that Christ died for you and that he loves you and he wants to fill that hole that is in your heart. All you need to do in your own words and in your own way is just ask God to forgive you, because you understand sin has ruined or is ruining your life. It's ruined relationships. Maybe drug and alcohol has caused you to lose your job, or there's a myriad of things. But this I do know, that if you just cry out to Jesus and say, I am a sinner, please forgive me. I want to do better. I just don't know how. Would you come into my heart and forgive me of my sins and help me to walk out the lifestyle that you would have me to walk out? I'm ready to do it. In your own words, share that with the Lord. And the Lord will come in. Hallelujah. He'll make himself known to you. And he'll help you from this day forward. You don't have to be, he's not asking you to come in and be perfect. He's asking you to come in and let him grow you, let him mature you toward perfection. You're never going to be perfect, but you're going to be at peace. You're going to live a transformed life, a life full of joy, and you're going to have the backing of God through every step along the way. Please, in this season when there's just joy in the air, cry out to God and ask him to save you. It'll be the best decision that you've ever made. Father, we thank you, Lord God, today. Hallelujah. I personally thank you in a very special way. Father, in the name of Jesus, I am so glad to say that to anybody, I am a child of God. I pray, Father, this word would fall on all of our hearts and all of our minds, and that, Father, in the name of Jesus, we would develop an unconditional love for people who it is hard to love. Move by your spirit and just fall upon us, Lord God, in a very special way, that as we leave from this place, we'll leave with a different understanding, Lord God, of walking in obedience to your word. We're living with a different understanding, Lord God, of what it means, hallelujah, for us to love people right where they are. We'll live with a different understanding, Lord God, and a joy of spending all of eternity with you. Hallelujah. Not because we've earned it, but because we lived the perfect life, but we come to know Jesus as our Lord and Savior. And so simply have your way even now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Praise God. That's all I have for you today. I pray that you were blessed in some way, ministered to. And I pray that this season, that we would really try to show unconditional love to people who are sometimes hard to love. Amen. People who are without, people who are struggling. Amen. People who may be in some kind of addiction. Hey, you can't just tell a person, quit that. Amen. They ought to just quit doing that stuff. I hear people say that, and it bothers me because I was addicted to crack cocaine for 9 years, and I couldn't just come out. Amen. I couldn't just come out. I needed some help, praise God. And I got all the help I need in Christ Jesus. So I love you guys. Praise God. Be safe. And we'll see you at the next appointed time. God bless.